Manakam. When we need to understand the principles of nerve repair and reconstruction, we are not talking only about the principles per se, but also the techniques. The techniques differ in different situations. How to deal with the totally transected nerve when the patient presents to us in the acute situation immediately after the injury, and what is the technique to deal with the same patient when he presents in a delayed setting, say for a few months after the injury. When exploring the nerve, what do we do when we find there is a gap between the nerve ends? Can we pull the ends together and suture it, or should we put in a nerve graft? If so, what nerve graft should we prefer? Should we put in an autograft, an allograft, or a nerve conduit? What should we do? How do we decide? How do we deal with a nerve that looks intact anatomically on exploration, but there is a small swelling on that particular portion of the nerve which is supposed to be injured? And finally, what is the role of nerve glue and nerve conduits, and what are the different types of nerve conduits available? If we understand and if we follow the principles of nerve repair and reconstruction, we'll be able to get an excellent result. Before we go into the actual principles and the techniques of nerve repair and reconstruction, we need to first make a decision regarding the management in different situations, like whether it is a sharp or a crush penetrating injury, or a blunt injury, or a stretch avulsion injuries, or chronic compression injuries like entrapment neuropathies. If it has been a sharp or a crush injury which has been penetrating, and on clinical examination, if there is a nerve deficit, it should be explored within 72 hours and primary repair planned. If there is a delayed presentation of this patient, we need to remember that it will be difficult to mobilize the proximal and distal ends. Hence, accurate coaptation may be difficult. There may be associated major vascular or bony injury which may mask the nerve injury clinically, and post-operative investigations such as MRI or nerve conduction studies may be done if necessary, and secondary repair or reconstruction planned. When there has been a blunt trauma leading to a burst wound, the nerves usually are resistant to injury because of their elasticity, as shown in this patient who had a fall of a heavy object on the right hand, where exploration revealed rupture of the digital arteries, but the digital nerves were found to be intact. But the involvement of the nerve in such injuries may range from neuropraxia to mixed nerve involvement. The associated soft tissue involvement and compartment syndrome may preclude early repair in such injuries. The nerve portion is usually treated conservatively in such situations. Secondary nerve repair or reconstruction after serial clinical examination and electrodiagnostic studies are recommended. In situations where there are stretch or avulsion injuries, as happens in brachial plexus injuries, the internal structure of the nerve is injured without any appreciable external injury, and even complete avulsion of the nerve may occur. The management protocol in such situations depends on the availability of the proximal and distal segments. If the proximal segment is available, repair with a nerve graft can be done, and if the proximal segment is not available, a nerve or a tendon transfer needs to be done. It also depends on the availability of the distal nerve segment. If the distal nerve segment is available, the nerve grafting or nerve transfer can be done depending on the availability of the proximal segment. And if the distal nerve segment is not available, implantation of the proximal nerve or the nerve graft needs to be done into the muscle to achieve good function. In case of chronic compression injuries, as seen in entrapment neuropathies, investigations about the involvement, exploration, and release of the compressing agent, which could be a fibrous tissue or a bone, should be done first. Then the involved nerve should be tackled. We may need a neurolysis or a management of the neuroma in continuity, or a distal nerve transfer, or distal tendon transfer. Having seen the different management protocols, we shall now see the principles of nerve repair or reconstruction. We shall be dealing with the principles under the headings of repair of nerve in a total or partial transection, repair of a nerve in a delayed setting, management of a neuroma in continuity, and lastly, management of a nerve gap. Before we go into the techniques of nerve repair, we need to understand the basics that are required in all these surgeries. Good anesthesia, good illumination, good magnification with a loop to be used during the dissection, and the microscope to be used during the actual repair. Generous operative field, which consists of good exposure and a good hemostasis. We also need to remember that the entire limb must be kept exposed during the surgery to check for the passive range of movements, and sharp dissection in the anatomic plane starting from the virgin tissues and progressing towards the lesion. And it is also important to preserve the fat and synovium planes, which are the nerve's gliding planes. And finally, we need to remember that primary nerve repair is the ideal repair, especially when done early. This primary nerve repair can be done in different ways. First, we need to make a good exposure, a liberal incision over the proximal and distal course of the nerve to allow a good visualization of the injured nerve ends. Then the identification and dissection of both the proximal and the distal ends of the nerve needs to be done. And after the atraumatic dissection of the nerve ends, we need to determine whether there is a complete or partial transection of the nerve. We need to then ensure whether the ends of the nerve are good. For this, we evaluate the injured fascicles and trim the fascicles back, both proximally and distally, until there is a bright red bleeding from both the ends of the nerve. It is now that we assess the distance between the two ends of the nerve. Having prepared both the nerve ends, we need to remember that we should ensure a tension-free suture line after repair. This should be tension-free while suturing and while moving the joints of the limb through the extremes of range of motion. We need to resist the urge to use positional posturing of the injured part to achieve a primary repair. Keeping the wrist in acute flexion just to achieve a primary repair should be avoided. At this juncture, we are likely to come across three situations. A situation where the ends of the nerve come together easily, there is no gap at all, or there may be a slight gap of about 1 to 2 centimeters, or there may be a much bigger gap that is more than 2 centimeters. If the nerve ends can be brought together with no tension whatsoever, even with the full range of motion of the part, then a primary repair can be done. And this is usually possible only in clean, sharp lacerations treated shortly after injury. If there is a slight gap, that is less than 2 centimeters, gentle mobilization of the injured nerve ends both proximally and distally can be done. Manipulating the proximal and distal joints can be done, but extreme caution should be used and not more than 20 degrees of flexion at the wrist is permissible. In some situations, the course of the nerve can be shortened. For example, the ulnar nerve transposition can be done. The final test is applying an epineural stitch with 8-0 polyamide between the two nerve ends. If it holds, primary suturing can be done. If not, it must be treated as a nerve gap. But if there is a nerve gap of more than 2 centimeters, it must be treated as discussed later in this video. We shall now see the actual techniques of primary nerve repair, which can be done using suturing techniques or sutureless techniques. The suturing techniques consist of epineural repair, epineural sleeve repair, group fascicular repair, and individual fascicular repair. In epineural repair, only the epineurium is sutured between the two ends of the nerve. This is the epineural layer which can support a suture. When suturing the epineurium, we need to remember that the fascicles should be aligned to each other. This can be done by two techniques. One is aligning the fascicles that can be seen, or aligning the nerve ends by the basa nervorum that run on the surface of the nerve. Once the alignment is done, bites are taken in the epineurium, taking care not to involve the underlying fascicles in the bite that is taken. The suture material used usually is 80, 90 or 10-0 polyamide, and the technique of suturing is simple interrupted sutures. The number of such sutures to be taken is just enough for coaptation of the edges of the nerve ends. At the end of the epineural suturing, it must look like this from the outside, and inside there should be a good coaptation of the fascicular bundles. What we need to be careful to avoid in an epineural repair is a gap between the fascicles, overlapping of the fascicle ends, and fascicle ends protruding through the epineural repair. These three situations are not conducive to good growth of the axons, and hence poor results will ensue. When there is a contusion associated with the ends of the transected nerve stump, epineural sheath can be peeled back on the distal nerve stump, the contused fascicles trimmed by about a millimeter or so, and alignment is then done using the vasa nervorum, and the distal epineural sleeve is then sutured over the proximal sleeve. In the technique of fascicular repair, individual fascicles are aligned using perineural sutures, or groups of fascicles are aligned using internal epineurium sutures. These techniques will ensure good fascicular alignment, but use of at least two sutures per fascicle is needed, and this causes an intraneural scar development and reduction of blood flow. Clinical studies show no advantages of this technique over a properly done epineural suturing. However, there are some indications for fascicular repair. Grouped fascicular repair is advised for coaptation of mixed motor or sensory nerves when the fascicles serving different functions are clearly defined. Example, ulnar nerve at the wrist and the radial nerve proximal to the elbow before the bifurcation into the motor division, which is the posterior interosseous nerve, and the superficial sensory radial nerve. The technique of individual fascicular repair is indicated only in nerve grafting and in most distal targets, that is, the example of the motor branch of the median nerve just before the entry into the muscle. When this branch has to be neurotized, individual fascicular repair is advisable. But not all patients present early. Some patients may present later, in which situation the nerve repair is done in a delayed setting when the presentation is more than 3 weeks. The amount of dissection will be more because of scarring, and a proximal neuroma and a distal glioma will be present at the proximal and distal ends of the cut nerve, and there may be a gap between the nerve ends after preparation. The proximal neuroma and the distal glioma must be dealt with effectively by what is known as the bread loafing technique. Using a fresh scalpel blade, we need to section 2 to 3 mm intervals until a soft nerve face with recognizable bundle architecture is reached. This should be done both on the proximal and the distal segments. At the end of the preparation, there will be a nerve gap between the proximal prepared stump and the distal prepared stump, and the management of this nerve gap is dealt with later in this video. Sometimes we come across a situation where the nerve looks anatomically intact with a swelling at the site of injury. It could be a complete neuroma in continuity, that is, there is no transmission of signals and no functioning component, and is treated with resection and nerve grafting. It could also be an incomplete neuroma in continuity or a mixed sixth degree injury described by Seddon, Mackinnon and Dellen. This usually occurs after a partial nerve injury. Here, we must be careful not to downgrade the patient's function by sacrificing the functioning components of the nerve. When a neuroma in continuity is suspected, we need to assess preoperatively to determine which fascicular components are functioning and should be preserved. We need to do another assessment intraoperatively by separating the individual fascicles proximal and distal to the neuroma using a microneuralysis technique, and then using a handheld nerve stimulator or intraoperative nerve conduction testing to test the integrity of these fascicles that appear to be intact. For example, when there is a neuroma in continuity of the median nerve and there is a good function of the thenar muscles, it indicates that the motor fascicles to the thenar muscles are intact and they must be preserved. Intraoperative nerve testing can identify these motor fascicles proximal and distal to the neuroma, and the remaining sensory fibers divided proximally and distally reconstructed with grafts bypassing the neuroma containing the intact motor fascicles. The other technique is to dissect through the neuroma in continuity, identify the intact fascicles, spare them, and excise only the fascicles that are involved and reconstruct those gaps using nerve grafts. After a perfectly done nerve repair, we also need to take care of the nerve bed. That is, the repaired nerve must not be left to lie against a naked tendon. The synovium must be drawn together over the tendon to prevent it from lying in contact with the repaired nerve. The repaired nerve must also not be left to lie against a lacerated muscle belly. Rotation of either the adjacent synovium or the undamaged fat should be done to interpose between the repaired nerve and the lacerated muscle belly. There are some sutureless repair devices also, like use of fibrin glue, which acts by the coagulation cascade, cyanoacrylate, which hardens in contact with water or cell membranes, laser tissue welding, where laser produces heat, denatures the structural proteins causing adhesion, albumin solder laser welding. Here, the links occur between the collagen fibers in the epineurium, and photochemical tissue bonding, where a light absorbing dye like rose bengal bonds with the epineural proteins. You can note that the tensile strength of these mechanisms is not very high, so they may not be used individually as techniques of nerve repair, but they can be used in conjunction with the suturing techniques. So far, we have seen techniques of nerve repair where the ends of the nerve come together and we are able to do a good repair. What happens when there is a nerve gap? How do we reconstruct these defects? The commonest methods for managing nerve gap are use of nerve autograft, nerve allograft, nerve conduits, end-to-side nerve transfer, and distal nerve transfer or vascularized nerve transfer. We shall be discussing about all these techniques except the technique of distal nerve transfer and vascularized nerve transfer, which will be dealt with in another video. The nerve autograft is harvested from the same patient and is a specialized nerve conduit containing Schwann cells. The indication for a nerve autograft is when direct repair is not possible without undue tension. The advantages of the nerve autograft are it forms the gold standard of reconstruction because there are Schwann cells available in the extracellular matrix which play a big role in the regeneration of the axons from the proximal end. However, nerve autografts have their own disadvantages. They need a second operative site for harvesting the donor nerve. It results in a donor sensory loss and potential for neuroma formation or pain. These sensory nerve autografts do not support motor regeneration as well as motor or mixed sensory motor nerves. And of course, the availability of autografts are limited. An important technique in nerve autografting is matching the graft and the recipient, or matching the donor and the recipient. The working end of the nerve is the endoneural surface and not the diameter of the nerve ends. To make this determination, it is important to trim back the epineurium to uncover the endoneural surface. In this illustrative example, we can see that both the epineurium and the endoneurium matching is good. Whereas in this example, the epineurium matching is good, but there is an endoneural mismatch. When the coaptation between these two ends is done, the result may not be optimal. Here, there is an epineural mismatch, but there is an endoneural match. The donor nerve for the nerve autograft can be chosen according to the need. If a single nerve graft is required of a short length, the posterior intraosseous nerve terminal portion can be used. If a longer single nerve graft is required, the medial antibrachial cutaneous nerve or the lateral antibrachial cutaneous nerve can be used. If multiple number of nerve grafts are used of short length, the medial antibrachial cutaneous nerve can be used. If a longer nerve graft is required, the sural nerve can be used. It is important to remember that when using autografts, we need to reverse the graft so that there is no loss of growing axons into the branches of the nerve. The second technique to manage nerve gaps is using nerve allografts. Donor-related or cadaveric nerve allografts can be used for devastating or segmental nerve injuries. These nerve allografts contain both viable donor Schwann cells and endoneural microstructure. And because of the presence of these cells in the allograft, the patient will require systemic immunosuppression. When using nerve allografts, the usual clinical protocol is as follows. ABO matched donors must be used. Small diameter donor nerves can be used. Cold preservation at 4 to 5 degrees Celsius for 7 days and 3 days of pre-treatment with FK506 or tacrolimus and continued immunosuppression until the tinel sign has crossed the distal graft site, which may extend for up to about 18 months. The advantages of the use of nerve allograft are that they can potentially allow functional recovery equivalent to the autograft with no donor site morbidity associated with the autograft. The disadvantages are that the patient requires systemic immunosuppression and the patient may be vulnerable to opportunistic infections. Since it is the presence of cellular components in the nerve allograft which necessitates immunosuppressive therapy, various techniques have been tried to remove the cellular components like cold preservation, lyophilization and irradiation. When the cellular components are removed, the graft immunogenicity is reduced to a great extent, and this allograft is known as the acellular allograft. But here, the lack of viable Schwann cells limits the acellular allograft to short gap distances of 3 cm, especially for sensory nerves only. The advantages of the acellular allograft are: it retains the scaffolding matrix of the nerve tissue, it is non-immunogenic and inert, and it acts as a biological substrate for nerve regeneration without the need for immunosuppression. The disadvantage being, there is a length limitation, less than 3 to 5 cm, there are no Schwann cells and only used for small diameter nerves and expensive at present. So these allografts can be used for digital nerve reconstruction with up to about 3 cm gap to get good results or up to 7 cm gap to get satisfactory results. In the use of major peripheral nerve reconstruction, the results are promising and up to 100 mm gap. The next option which shows promise is the use of nerve conduits. The nerve conduit bridging technique involves enclosing the proximal and distal nerve segments in tubes so that the regenerating axons from the growth cone sprout toward the distal stump, proceeding within the original path and avoiding misdirection problems. The conduit also precludes the entrance of surrounding tissues into the gap, creating a protected microenvironment rich in neurotrophic factors which help in the axonal regeneration. So the advantages of the nerve conduits are, they circumvent the adverse effects of the autografts and allografts and they serve as guides for the regenerating nerve. The disadvantages are the length limitation, which can be only less than 3 cm, and they can be used only for small diameter sensory nerves, and there are no Schwann cells, there is no matrix, and they are expensive again at present. Basically, nerve conduits can be biologic or synthetic, and the synthetic conduits can be non-degradable or degradable. The biologic nerve conduits that have been used have been veins, muscles, even tendons. The commonest use were the superficial veins, which can be used for gaps of less than 30 millimeters. The results are equivalent to that achieved with the use of nerve autografts, and the results are also equivalent to the use of polyglycolic acid nerve conduits. synthetic non-degradable nerve conduits like the silastic and the polyvinyl alcohol conduits are available, but they have their own disadvantages because of the foreign body reaction. The synthetic degradable nerve conduits like the polyglycolic acid PGA or the caprolactone and the collagen semi-permeable type 1 nerve conduits are also getting into vogue. But nerve conduits aren't just the plain tubes they were when they started off. The next generation of nerve conduits became semi-permeable and porous, and the third generation nerve conduits are sometimes loaded with support cells to provide oriented nerve guidance. Sometimes they release nerve growth factors and sometimes even provide electrical conductivity to promote the growth of the nerve. When the nerve conduit is applied, in the first stage, it is filled with a protein-rich fluid containing neurotrophic factors. Then this gets converted into a fibrin-rich scaffold which supports the growth of the axon. Then there is a cell migration that occurs which includes the Schwann cells. And lastly, the axonal cable elongates. So the nerve conduits are ideally indicated for gaps in the small sensory nerves, especially the digital nerves with a gap of less than 1 centimeter. In the use of nerve conduits in major peripheral nerves, there is a paucity of non-sponsored studies and mixed results have been obtained. So you can note that the growth of the axon in the nerve autograft is much quicker than that in the acellular allograft and least in the nerve conduit. And in the nerve conduit, it grows to a variable functionality within the nerve conduit. Nerve wraps are sometimes applied around the nerve following nerve repairs or neuralysis. They protect the nerve and the suture line from adhesions and scars. They can be biologic or synthetic nerve wraps. The commonest used biologic nerve wraps are vein grafts. The synthetic nerve wraps have selective permeability. They allow the nutrient diffusion but block the fibroblast migration. The last technique of managing nerve gaps is the end-to-side repair. The advantage of this is there is no length limitation, but the disadvantage is that there are poor sensory results and motor end-to-side repair requires donor neurectomy, which may result in donor site issues. This type of terminolateral neurography involves the coaptation of the distal stump of the transected nerve, that is the recipient nerve, to the side of an intact nerve, which is called as the donor nerve. It involves the creation of an epineural window on the donor nerve, matching the caliber of the diameter of the acceptor nerve. Possible collateral sprouting occurs from the undamaged donor nerves to neurotize the recipient. After performing any of the techniques that we have discussed so far, the functional recovery is inversely proportional to the time of denervation and directly proportional to the number of motor axons reaching the target end plate. The factors that can affect this outcome are patient factors, injury factors and treatment factors. As far as the patient factors are concerned, results of nerve repair in children and young adults are better, partly because there is a shorter distance to the target organ and also because a child's brain plasticity, that is, the ability to process the re-innervated motor and sensory stimuli within the brain cortex, is more facile than an adult's. If the injury is more proximal, the prognosis is usually poorer, because the proximal injuries involve mixed nerves and distal injuries involve pure sensory or motor nerves, which have a better prognosis after repair. Similarly, crush or avulsion type injuries of the nerve have a poorer prognosis than a sharp injury occurring at the same level. Best results after nerve repair are obtained when the nerve repair is performed before 3 weeks and especially before 72 hours from the time of injury. Tension-free suturing using fine suture material and good coaptation of the fascicles will ensure a good prognosis. The use of appropriate and judicious grafting can also give good results. I hope you liked the video. I loved making it. Please click on the shown links to see more about the basics of nerve anatomy, physiology, and nerve injury and healing. And do not forget to subscribe to keep connected with the latest in Learning Hand Surgery.